I want you to imagine with me, if you will. Imagine you are living in Israel in the first century AD, and you are a Jew. Your nation is known as Yahweh's people, chosen by God to be the way He wants to show the world the extent of His love for all. At the core of your identity is the people who God delivered from Egypt and spoke to through the prophets. The prophets you hear about in the scriptures read out loud to you from massive scrolls at synagogue talk about judgment and punishment if your people don't return to God and worship Him alone. But you hear these words of the prophets and you find that they also promise forgiveness, redemption, and salvation if you do turn back to God. But for the last 400 years, God has seemingly not said anything to your people. No angels, no prophets, silence. Then you start hearing rumors about a priest in the temple encountering an angel who struck him mute. And you hear about a young girl who was told by an angel that she will fall pregnant even though she's a virgin. And like a crack of a whip, 400 years of silence was shattered when two angels spoke to people. One a priest, which was par for the course for how God spoke to His people in the Old Testament. But the other one was a young woman, not at all the type of person who you would typically know would hear from God. But that was not the end. 9 months later, a group of shepherds in the field didn't just encounter one angel, but a whole host of angels. And you hear about pagan wise men from distant lands who followed a star and worshipped at the crib of the King of the Jews. No, not a crib, a manger. 3 decades pass, and you find yourself in Jerusalem to attend the Passover festival, as you do year after year. You look forward to celebrating this moment God set aside for your people to remember Him delivering you from slavery and to remember how God has set you aside. But you hear crowds shouting during the week. One day they're shouting, "Hosanna," but the other day they're shouting, "Crucify Him." And then silence. Until 3 days later, when you hear stories about a man who was killed being raised to life again. And you investigate further and come to believe these stories these people are telling. You gather with these people and you pray and you fellowship with them and you hear how they went with Jesus to the mountain and at that moment He ascended into heaven with the promise of the Holy Spirit left behind. And then one day, while you were with others praying and singing, you hear a loud noise, like a really loud, strong wind. You look up and see these flames coming and lingering above each head in the room. And suddenly you all start speaking in different languages. You spill outside of the room ready to share this moment with others, and you find yourself preaching in a language you didn't understand, but people are responding. What was 400 years of silence was no more. And the words of the prophet Joel ring in your ears. In these last days, God says, I will pour out my spirit on all people. Welcome to Pentecost Sunday. Today we celebrate the gift of the Holy Spirit to us as believers and the church of our Lord Jesus Christ. And so I want to pray a prayer for us quickly. So let us pray. Come, Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of your faithful and kindle in us the fire of your love. Send forth your Spirit and we shall be created and you shall renew the face of the earth. O God, who by the light of the Holy Spirit that instruct the hearts of your faithful. Grant that by that same Holy Spirit, we may be truly wise and ever enjoy your consolations. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So if you want to read along, please open to Acts chapter 2. It is the story of Pentecost in the Bible. We're going to read the majority of the chapter, so bear with me. But Acts chapter 2, we'll start at verse 1. Acts chapter 2, verse 1. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. Then they saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in different tongues as the Spirit enabled them. Now they were staying in Jerusalem, God-fearing Jews from every nation under heaven. When they heard this sound, a crowd came together in bewilderment, because each one heard their own language being spoken. Utterly amazed, they asked, "Aren't all these who are speaking Galileans? Then how is it that each of us hears them in our native language? Parthians, Medes and Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya near Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts to Judaism, Cretans and Arabs, we hear them declaring the wonders of God in our own tongues." Amazed and perplexed, they asked one another, "What does this mean?" Some, however, made fun of them and said they had had too much wine. Then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice and addressed the crowd, "Fellow Jews, and all of you who live in Jerusalem, let me explain this to you. Listen carefully to what I say. These people are not drunk, as you suppose. It is only 9 a.m. No, this is what was spoken to us by the prophet Joel. In the last days, God says, I will pour my spirit on all people. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your old men will see visions and your young men will dream dreams. Your young men will see visions and your old men will dream dreams. Even on my servants, both men and women, I will pour out my spirit in those days, and they will prophesy. I will show wonders in the heavens above and signs in the earth below, blood and fire and billows of smoke. The sun will be turned to darkness and the moon to blood before the coming of the great and glorious day of our Lord. And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved." Fellow Israelites, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth was a man accredited by God to you by miracles, wonders and signs which God did among you through him, and as you yourself know. This man was handed over to you by God's deliberate plan and foreknowledge, and you, with the help of wicked men, put him to death by nailing him to the cross. But God raised him from the dead, freeing him from the agony of death, because it was impossible for death to keep hold of him. David said about him, "I saw the Lord always before me. Because he is at my right hand, I will not be shaken. Therefore my heart is glad and my tongue rejoices. My body will also rest in hope, because you will not abandon me to the realm of the dead. You will not let your Holy One see decay. You have made known to me the paths of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence. Fellow Israelites, I can tell you confidently that the patriarch David died and was buried, and his tomb is here to this day. But he was a prophet and knew that God had promised him on oath that he would place one of his descendants on his throne. Seeing what was to come, he spoke of the resurrection of the Messiah, that he was not abandoned to the realm of the dead, nor did his body see decay. God raised this Jesus to life, and we are all witnesses of it. Exalted to the right hand of God, he has received from the Father the promised Holy Spirit and has poured out what you now see and hear. For David did not ascend to heaven, and yet he said, 'The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet.' Therefore, let all Israel be assured of this. God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Messiah." Then when the people heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter with the other apostles, "Brothers, what shall we do?" Peter replied, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins. And you receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The promise is for you and your children, for all who are far off, for all whom the Lord God will call. With many other words, he warned them and pleaded with them, save yourselves from this corrupt generation. Those who accepted his message were baptized, and about 3,000 were added to their number that day. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Last week I spoke about the Father and how the Son and the Spirit glorify and point to the Father. Remember the Spider-Man meme. Today, because it is Pentecost, we move on to talking about the Spirit and specifically what the Spirit does. Now, this naturally cannot be covered all in just one sermon. So when we're back to the sermon series in a few weeks' time, we will continue to talk about the Spirit. But for today, I want to talk about what myself and many other Reformed theologians would say is the primary role of the Spirit in our lives. Now, I think if you gather a group of Christians together and you line them up and you ask them what the primary role of the Spirit is, you'll probably get as many different answers as there are people. I think the first few answers you'll get is something like, he empowers us, he gives us gifts, he sets us free. And all of these answers are not wrong. He does indeed do this for us. But I think if you get stuck on the idea of what the primary thing the Spirit does for us is give us gifts, then that leaves us with two logical problems. The first one is that, I don't know about you, but I'm not necessarily seeing prophecy and healing and tongues, the things that we understand to be the gifts of the Spirit, I'm not necessarily seeing that every single day. They shouldn't be at all rare in the church. I think Reformed churches, we love you. This is a thing we struggle with when it comes to the gifts of the Spirit. It shouldn't be rare in the church. But I, as I said, I'm not experiencing those gifts of the Spirit every single day. And that means if I'm not experiencing those gifts of the Spirit every single day, then I'm not experiencing the primary role of the Spirit in my life on a daily basis, if we say that is the number one thing that he does. So you can see this is a problem. The main thing, if you say the main thing he does is give us gifts, but we're not experiencing the gifts every day, that's a problem, because we're not experiencing the main thing that he does on a daily basis. Along with this, I also know that it's factually not true, because the Bible tells us that God is always with us. And he's always working in our lives. So we know the Spirit is constantly working on a daily basis in our lives. The other problem with saying that the primary role of the Spirit is that it gives us gifts is that I then become the center of the Spirit's primary role. It's about me. He gives me gifts. It's about him empowering me. And again, we saw last week that this is not true. As the Trinity seeks to glorify each other, and then invites us into that space of deep love and glorification of God. Okay? There's what I've just said also comes with a problem, because realistically, the Spirit gives us gifts for the church, not for me. But we do see in a lot of churches nowadays that the gifts become a kind of self-centered thing and not something for the church. So even if we say the Spirit's main thing is give us gifts, that should be in order to help the church, not just the individual. Okay? So the primary role of the Spirit is not to give us gifts. Then what is it? And the answer, surprisingly, is seen in Acts 2, but isn't directly said. The wording for what the primary thing the Spirit does, we can find in John 14, verse 26, where Jesus says to the disciples, "But the advocate / parakletos, as we've spoken about this before, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I have said to you." So what does this mean? It means the primary role of the Spirit is to point to Jesus. That's the main thing that he does. Amen. Who, if the Spirit is pointed to Jesus, Jesus then himself points us to the Father. The Father is the one who gives us the Spirit and gives it to the Son. You can start seeing that thing that I spoke about, that kind of spiral dance, that pointing to one another. It is all happening within the nature of the Trinity. They are pointing to each other. The Spirit is with us, and He is to us as Jesus was to His disciples. The Spirit reminds us of Jesus daily. He points us to Jesus. He teaches us to understand what Jesus said and what Jesus taught. He is the one reminding us constantly of the Son. This is why in the benediction at the end of every single service on a Sunday in this church, we say, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God our Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, our guide and counselor. We have grace because of Jesus. We spoke previously about the deep love the Father has for us. We spoke about the Father being our Father 2 weeks ago. And now we come to understand that when we talk about the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, we talk about the nearness of God that we experience in our lives because we have the Spirit of God with us daily, walking with us in our joys and in our sorrows, in our pain and our relief, in our depression and our celebration. The Spirit is with us as a fellow, someone who walks alongside us, helping us, guiding us, consoling us, counseling us. That is what it means when we say the Spirit is our paraclete, our parakletos. The word, for those who don't know, comes from the Greek word parakletos, which Jesus uses in John 14, verse 16 to describe the Spirit. And we often find it in different translations being translated in different ways. Some say helper, some say advocate, some say counselor. It's different words. But it's different words because, long story short, it's a very difficult word to translate into one single English word. Okay? That's why you get different words in different translations. But this is why we say the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, our guide and counselor in the benediction. Because those are only two words which help us understand what the parakletos is. What it means for the Spirit to walk alongside us, to counsel and console and to guide and to help. The Spirit is with us daily. He's walking alongside us in our lives. But most importantly, He points us to Jesus. How do we see this happen in the Pentecost story? Well, this is why I wanted to read the majority of the chapter today. What happens to Peter when he's filled with the Holy Spirit for the first time? If you think about it, what happens? He goes out and he starts preaching. And what does he preach about? Jesus Christ crucified and raised to life by that same Spirit that flooded the room and who is in us right now. That's what he preaches about. We see this beautiful moment. As a side note, we all saw that devastating power of that explosion in Beirut, what was it, 2020? You know, with that factory that had the fertilizer in it and that explosion. I wonder if that devastating sound and flood of air, because you just see this shockwave and buildings, dust fly away and glass shatters. I wonder if that flood of air was what it was like to be in the room that day the Spirit came, but this time not devastating, but full of life, renewal, and revival. Was it this kind of explosion of air? We had that storm a few weeks ago that left Port Simonsburg, for those who have been there, a bit devastated from the shelter, like the outside shelter and things like that. Cape Town, we know rough wind. We know hard wind. So you can imagine being in a room and just suddenly this of wind coming in. But it is that thing of, we don't want to go and close windows. It's not that kind of wind. It is this powerful, life-giving, Holy Spirit-filled wind. Many of us here today might hear the story of Pentecost. We might hear the words of Peter going and preaching Jesus Christ, empowered by the Spirit of God to do so. Think to ourselves, gee, I wish I'd seen something like that. Or I wish something like that would happen again. Or maybe you at the moment are feeling a little bit lost or hopeless or tired or hurting to even desire something so miraculously good and awesome. This year has been quite tough on our little congregation. We've lost some remarkable members, either because they've moved away or the Lord has called them home. On Thursday, for those who don't know, this past week, Catherine DeFloy, Candy and Douglas Taylor, their daughter, she lost her husband suddenly. 40 years old, just didn't wake up to go to duty. Healthy man. We've had many falls, literal, in the church. We've had many aches and pains. And in many ways, this year, medically, has been more difficult for us as a church than 2020 was. Maybe right now we need a paracletos to come alongside us and point us to Jesus, to comfort us and to console us, to bring us back to the Son who can show us grace and mercy, who can love us and give us His Spirit of peace as the Father overshadows us with His wings. We are no longer living in 400 years of silence. We are living in a time when the Spirit of God is indeed with us. And by that Spirit, we know we are adopted into God's family. And by that Spirit, we can cry out, Abba, Father. And by that Spirit, we can say, Jesus is Lord. So let us pray and ask God once again to send His Spirit on us to heal and to give peace, to guide and to comfort, and to point us to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who by the power of that same Spirit living in us was raised to life again after giving it up to save a wretch like me. We need to learn to pray together again as a church. Not necessarily, Temple United Church, yes, but also as a whole church. We don't pray together enough. That, I think, was one of the things I've mentioned before. Feel free to come Tuesday mornings, 9 o'clock. We gather and we pray together. And I've mentioned a few times now just how that is one of my favorite times of the week, to just sit with members of the congregation and lift up this congregation to the Lord. If you're available Tuesday mornings, 9 o'clock, come and join. It is beautiful to pray together. And we also get a chance in our small little group to pray for each other. One thing that, this is now completely off script, but anyway, one thing that we did this week, the denomination, UPCSA, had a conference, an online conference, speaking about starting the fire and lighting the fire and keeping the fire going and passing the fire on to the next generation. And it was fantastic. And the very first talk was done by Rod Botsis, who's preached here a few times before. And he spoke about the moment that a lot of members in our denomination see as being the moment the charismatic revival hit the UPCSA. And it was at a retreat for youth pastors and youth leaders in Durban at Camp David, for those who knew Camp David. That's the USA. Jonathan, I think. I don't know, whatever. The campsite in the KZN. And the guy who called us together gathered together and they said, we want to just have a moment because ministry is difficult for us to share and talk together. And he started talking and then he started confessing some of his sins. And it sparked this moment of a room full of well-known leaders in our denomination just confessing to one another their sins and then praying for one another. And it was this holy moment fueled by the Holy Spirit. I encourage you, find people to pray for you. It is so important. It is such a joy to be part of the prayer group on a Tuesday morning and every now and then, actually on a semi-regular basis. it's not on the prayer list, but it is on a semi-regular basis. Somebody at some point prays for me as the minister of the church. And it's so encouraging for me to sit there. And it's always been awkward the first few times. I don't want to be the center of your prayer, and you like, I'd rather be out the room when you pray for me. But it's become a beautiful moment of congregants lifting their minister up in prayer. Find people to pray for you. It is beautiful. Anyway, amen. Let us pray. This is a prayer to the Holy Spirit written by St. Augustine. And he writes this. Breathe into me, Holy Spirit, that my thoughts may all be holy. Move in me, Holy Spirit, that my work too may be holy. Attract my heart, Holy Spirit, that I may love only that which is holy. Strengthen me, Holy Spirit, that I may defend all that is holy. Protect me, Holy Spirit, that I may always be holy. Amen.